Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Good to see you, ma'am.
Nice to see you too.
Lovely seeing you, ma'am. And on top, thank you so much for giving us time for this interview, ma'am.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Assalamu alaikum. You're watching PTV World and I'm Faisal Rahman with an exclusive interview with a personality which I'm going to introduce. The lady is a former diplomat, a military strategist and a political scientist. She has also received Hilal-e-Imtiaz in 2002 and she has served twice as an ambassador to USA from Pakistan from 1993 to 1996. There was a time of Mohtarma Benazir Bhutto when she was the prime minister, and later on from 1999 till 2002. This was the time when General Musharraf was the president of Pakistan. She's also the member of the UN Security General's Advisory Board on Disarmament Affairs from 2001 till 2005. She's also been an ambassador in UK, and the lady has the honor to be the founding editor of the news and also the first editor, first Muslim woman to hold this position, being the editor of this very known newspaper, The Muslim. So we are talking about none other than Dr. Maleeha Lodhi. Thank you very much, ma'am, for taking out time, and you really are giving a very important interview to us today. And we're very thankful for, again, once again, that you have taken out your precious time. But ma'am, now let me begin with you as a career diplomat, and you have served in various capacities. First of all, ma'am, from being a journalist into this side where there's a different frame of mind altogether that you need to have, what sort of an experience was that?
I think the transition from journalism to diplomacy was not difficult. Of course, there's a challenge in any new assignment, but it wasn't difficult because there's such an overlap between the skills that you need as a diplomat and as a journalist. Both are in the business of communication. Mm-hmm. Both are in the business of persuading others, trying to win hearts and minds. So I think journalism had prepared me well for the task that I undertook. Of course, once I was called the accidental diplomat, because it never entered my mind that I would really serve my country in this position. It was the late Mohtarma Benazir Bhutto who offered me the position of ambassador to Washington. And I said to her at that time, I have no experience. Yes, I've been writing about foreign policy. I was one of the leading writers at that time on foreign policy issues. And she turned around and she said, you know, when I became prime minister, I had no experience either. So I think that was an argument that was very persuasive. So I took that up as a challenge. But I really do think that being a good diplomat requires the kind of skills that some you learn on the job, some, of course, you need to have beforehand. And I was very, very gratified, and I was very fortunate that the people at the foreign ministry at that time were very helpful. So they helped prepare me for one of the most important.
The interesting part is normally when you talk about the diplomats, they started, you know, as a third secretary, second secretary, first secretary, then the deputy ambassador, and then the ambassador. You were sent as an ambassador to the most important country, that was United States of America. How challenging that assignment was, ma'am?
Well, it was both personally and professionally challenging. Personally, because as you say, I had never done this before. However, I had a grounding in foreign policy. Also, I had taught international affairs, I had taught domestic politics. So, you know, both as an academic and a journalist, I had exposure. It was professionally challenging because I arrived there at a time of crisis in the relationship between Pakistan and the United States. As you know, relations have been a roller coaster.
Yeah.
We've seen ups and downs, troughs and peaks in this relationship. So I was there at a time when there were layers and layers of sanctions that the US had imposed. And my task at that time was to try to see how many of these sanctions could be removed and how Pakistan and the United States could get back to a normal relationship. And I must say, it was a very challenging time, and I'm happy that I contributed to the improvement of relations at that time. It was a small contribution and a modest contribution. But you know, when something happens on your watch, you do take special satisfaction.
And how different was your tenure the second time from the first?
Well, the second time too, I went at a time of crisis. So at times, my
friends... The war on terror was...
My friends in America and my friends in Pakistan used to say, you're like a firewoman. You know, you go out there to put out the fires. So I don't know whether I was a firewoman or not, and whether I was chosen by a very different government at that time because of my prior experience. But certainly, I think it was very different because it was a time when there were all sorts of misperceptions about Islam. You remember the word Muslim terrorism, Islamic terror. These were the, you know, lexicon that a lot of the media was using. So in a way, I landed up in a situation where I felt I had to represent not only Pakistan, but also Muslims. I had to speak out and explain that violence is something that is condemned, not acceptable, not accepted by our great faith, and that a small bunch of people who are carrying out these terror attacks, it should not be equated with Muslims or Islam. So I think the challenge was, you know, manifold. The challenge between trying to explain Pakistan's position and then the war that proceeded then in Afghanistan. So that was the period. Again, you know, you learn a lot on the job. I did a lot of media at that time because I felt at that time it was important to get out there in front of the TV cameras and explain what Pakistan's position was, because clearly there were lots of misperceptions. So my task was as much in the public domain as it was in negotiating, speaking,
because that was the time I still remember Richard Armitage visited Pakistan, and the offer was very simple. Either you're with us or you're not with us. So this kind of a the status of a non-NATO ally, do you think, ma'am, were we able to capitalize on that front, ma'am?
Well, I think the important thing is not the designation that somebody else gives to you. The important thing was that Pakistan had to protect its interests. We were in a difficult situation, and I think we did protect our interests at a very challenging time. The war that proceeded, we always said, from the very start, that there is no military solution to the dilemma in Afghanistan or this crisis in Afghanistan. From the very start, we advised the US administration of the time that you must start speaking to the Taliban. You must keep a door open, because ultimately you're going to find, you have to find a political solution. So we said that from the beginning.
Did you learn in 20 years?
Well, you know, it took them, what is it, 16, 17 years to get to that point. But you know, at least they are at that point now, and I think we should be hopeful and optimistic that there is a serious effort underway as we speak.
But I think Pakistan has done a good job recently. Do you think we've been able to win that confidence of the Americans, or that kind of mistrust? Do you think that has been eroded over the last couple of years, ma'am?
Well, I think, you know, the relationship between the two countries is in a new phase. That phase still has to be defined. But as far as, you know, your reference to militancy and violence perpetrated by terrorists, I think apart from the United States, or indeed anybody in the international community, Pakistan took actions in its own interest. And I think we have been able to largely defeat militancy in our country. And we've done it in our own interest. So I think that's the important thing.
Now, we used to hear about the existence of Al-Qaeda. That's no more now, because that has been totally taken care of when we talk about our Pakistani area. You talk about the presence of TTP or Taliban inside Afghanistan, though it's an indigenous movement, and the Taliban of the Afghan soil, they do not have any design beyond the borders of Afghanistan. But ma'am, there is one threat, that is about ISIS. Now, it is believed that a lot of presence of Daesh is also felt in Afghanistan.
Well, I think you make a very good point, and that also is additional reason why we must not delay a negotiated settlement to bring the long war in Afghanistan to an end, because the longer fighting continues in Afghanistan, the greater the threat of the kind that you mentioned, because then space opens up for militant groups like ISIS and others. So I think that is an argument for quick end to the Afghan war, something that Pakistan has always urged. Pakistan has never wanted this war to linger, to continue, to be such a protracted war. Yeah. And therefore, as I said, It's important for Pakistan to continue to assist in whatever way it is required to do to help in this political process that is underway now, so that there are talks that are going on between the United States and the Afghan Taliban. And we hope that these talks will also involve the Afghan government, because that's important. The Taliban do need to talk to the Afghan government as well. So we hope that the process will widen and then ultimately, and not taking too long, lead to a negotiated settlement.
Do you
to end
see
the war.
These talks being fruitful, ma'am, at some stage?
Yes,
because
absolutely.
It seems as if, you know, somebody is taking a step forward and then they're taking three steps back.
You know, after
they're ready to talk, and suddenly we
after
hear something
such
from,
a long
from
after such a long war, conflict, insurgency in Afghanistan, naturally, you're not going to be able to resolve all of these issues in a day. However, I think there is serious intent on all sides. And as I said, it is in Pakistan's interest to ensure, in whatever way it can, obviously, you know, it's the direct parties to the war that have to ultimately negotiate an end to that conflict. But in whatever way that Pakistan can assist, and as you know, we have assisted, we helped get the process off the ground. But ultimately, it's for the Afghan parties to decide what is in the best interest of their country. It's a sovereign decision. Pakistan respects that sovereign decision. And, you know, we look forward to a time when there is peace in Afghanistan, there is peace on our border, because as you know, on the other side of our border, we confront a very, very serious situation after what the Indian government did in occupied Jammu and Kashmir.
Well, since you have served in the capacity of an ambassador, but your latest assignment was as the permanent representative of the United Nations in the United States of America, and you served there for about five years. Ma'am, how different is that task from being the ambassador to USA?
You know, I must tell you about a quote that you might hear over and over again, that the difference between bilateral, you know, being in a bilateral post, which is just serving in one country, and a multilateral post, which is serving in an organization. And at the United Nations, if you will recall, you know, I became the first woman to be sent by Pakistan to represent our country at the United Nations, where you are really, in a way, ambassador through the world. So when I was presenting my credentials to the Secretary General, I said it took my country 70 years to send a woman. Mm-hmm. So you can see from that, we get it right at the end. So now I hope that, you know, after me, there will be other women who are also appointed to this post. So the quote that I wanted to cite to you mm-hmm. is that in bilateral relationship, you tend to meet the same people and work on the same issues pretty much all the time. In a multilateral post, you meet different people and work on different issues. That, in a very simplified way, is the difference. Obviously, when you serve in a post like ambassador to the United Nations, you're dealing with global issues,
okay,
not just bilateral issues. You're there, of course, to promote your country's interests, and your country's interests remain the same as they are in any bilateral position. But because you're in a multilateral organization, you're also dealing with global issues, mm-hmm. and you really learn to develop a respect for other countries' interests and other countries' concerns, whether those countries are large, medium, or small. Mm-hmm. So it's an extraordinary experience because there, as I said, you learn to align your country's interests with the interests of others, and you work towards shared goals, common interests. But of course, I mean, it's hugely competitive. You're also there to push your own country's goals and objectives.
Yeah.
And of course, to set a narrative, you know. And I think one of the things that I learned there, and of course it came from my bilateral experience as well, was that one of the best ways mm-hmm. to change the narrative, to change the conversation about your country,
is
through cultural diplomacy.
Cultural diplomacy. Mm-hmm.
And that is something that I think is underestimated, and it needs to be deployed much more by our country, because our country, as you know, has a rich tradition. We have an ancient roots. We have one of the oldest ancient civilizations.
Indeed.
Right here. You know, we come from an ancient civilization. So the cultural part of our identity needs to be deployed in a manner that people understand who we are, what makes us tick, our music, our art, and so much else.
And the general perception of Pakistan, forget about the Indian perspective, forget about how different other countries look at Pakistan. But during your tenure, I've seen you being, you were very vocal, you were raising the important, pertinent issues in a very appropriate manner, especially about Kashmir. Now, ma'am, during the 5-year tenure where you served as an ambassador or as a permanent representative of United Nations, ma'am, do you think we really capitalized during those 5 years? Were we able to highlight the Kashmir cause and the Kashmir issue, and in particular, the humanitarian crisis?
Yes, ma'am? I think that's a very good question. And the answer to that question is that yes, because at the United Nations, as you know, Kashmir, the issue of occupied Kashmir has been one of the oldest items on the agenda of the UN Security Council. So we have ensured every year that it remains on the agenda of the UN Security Council. Of course, efforts are made that it should no longer, it's no longer relevant, argue our detractors, argue our adversaries. So, you know, efforts are always made to do this. The other aspect I wanted to point out vis-a-vis Kashmir is, as you know, for the first time in over 50 years, and I was there in New York at the time, we managed to persuade the 15 members of the Security Council to convene a meeting, a special meeting, to discuss the situation that had been created.
This happened for the first time?
For the first time in 53 years, we had a UN Security Council meeting exclusively to discuss the situation in occupied Jammu and Kashmir in the wake of the Modi government's illegal annexation of Jammu and Kashmir last August. So it was in the wake of that, that a few weeks later, in fact a few days later, we managed to, as I said, persuade members of the Security Council and they discussed the issue. We have kept the UN system very well informed, my own meetings with the UN Secretary General, there were frequent meetings. I also frequently met with all members of the Security Council, both permanent and non-permanent. I asked the President of the UN Security Council to informally at least keep members briefed and updated. Plus, as you know, the human rights situation that you mentioned, you know, that aspect has obviously been the subject of statements that have been made by the UN Secretary General, by the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, and other UN officials. They have spoken out repeatedly about the human rights, grave human rights situation. So when you ask how Pakistan has managed to promote and to ensure that Kashmir is an issue that is on the agenda, that's in focus at the United Nations, these are some of the ways in which we have done so. But of course, given the situation on the ground, much more needs to be done.
Okay. And when you say much more needs to be done, let's elaborate that. What exactly do we need to do now? How to move forward from point A?
Well, I think the challenge is still to continue to work the Security Council to ensure that, you know, there are 11 Security Council resolutions specifically on Kashmir. There are many more that also refer to Kashmir, but these are specific to occupied Kashmir. So I think the challenge for us is to make sure that these resolutions are eventually implemented, because the fundamental right of self-determination, that is the right of the Kashmiri people, should be given to them. I mean, democracy can't be good for one set of people and not good for other sets of people. This is a travesty of history, justice, morality, you name it, of law. So Security Council resolutions constitute international law. So if that law is going to be violated, as it is, by the Indian government, then obviously it is our responsibility, Pakistan's responsibility, which we are, you know, obligated to carry forward to ensure that we do this. Plus, I think we must keep in view the following fact, which is that international public opinion has been fairly unanimous in condemning the Indian act in occupied Jammu and Kashmir, and has continued to voice its concern, as well as actually its critique of the actions that the Indian government continues to take, because the lockdown continues, as you know. So I think there also, you know, the challenge for Pakistan is to ensure that this international public opinion continues to remain focused on occupied Jammu and Kashmir. You know, globally, there are so many issues on the global agenda.
That's correct.
There is so much else that's going on. So I think when you say or when you ask what else is there for Pakistan to do, it is actually to ensure that the issue remains on the international agenda, in international focus, that it doesn't sort of fade from public view at the global level.
Constant effort needs to be put in.
Absolutely.
Ma'am, this year what we really loved and liked was the speech of the Prime Minister, well over 50 minutes. And I think he was able to at least make sure that people are listening to him, listening to the point of view of Pakistan. There were a couple of very important points. He did talk about money laundering and issues like that, Islamophobia. The last point was about Kashmir. Do you think, ma'am, that speech and that charisma which he had while he was delivering the speech, the kind of presence he had shown, the kind of attitude and kind of, you know, when he was speaking, everybody could tell that he's talking from his heart. Do you think, ma'am, that speech has made any difference?
Well, I think his speech, the Prime Minister's speech during his General Assembly visit, helped to consolidate the diplomatic momentum that Pakistan had achieved in getting the Security Council meeting, in also ensuring that, as I was saying before, that there is global attention on the issue. So the Prime Minister's bold speech, and you know, he pulled no punches, he was very, very clear in what he wanted the world to hear. I think that helped to further reinforce the diplomatic momentum and to ensure the voice of the Kashmiris was heard. I think the most important thing was this. It was important that the voice of the Kashmiri people, which has been muffled by the Indian government, by its blanket communication blackout, you know, that was totally sort of exploded in a way by the fact that the Prime Minister of Pakistan stood up in the UN General Assembly and said what he said about the plight of the people of occupied Jammu and Kashmir. So, you know, the Indian government may try to suppress the voice, but the voice was heard in the most important sort of global forum or global stage in the world.
Ma'am, when we say that, I've interviewed many ambassadors to USA, ma'am. I've spoken to Shari Rahman, Abdullah Hussain Harun, Zaz Chaudhary Saab also, ma'am. Now, they all had a very unanimous kind of an approach toward this, that we really need to work on our lobbying. Explain that to me. How important is that, ma'am? Because lobbying, this is what we end up hearing, that the Israeli lobby is very strong and now the Indian lobby is getting stronger. So that obviously means that the influence, the kind of, you know, you can persuade an individual or an organization. How important is that? And what sort of an effort has been made so far regarding that, ma'am?
Well, look, there are two aspects to the question that you ask. One is a country's interests, Pakistan's interests. I think Pakistan's interests are best expressed by diplomats.
Okay.
I mean, diplomats are professionals, that's why they're sent there. Government officials who interact then with diplomats here. So that aspect is extremely important. Mm-hmm. But the diplomats' work does not end by just speaking to the government, obviously. So the aspect of public diplomacy, and I return to that topic, is extremely important. The position of governments is shaped also by public opinion in their own countries. So Pakistan's ability to interact, to ensure that its position and interests are well understood by the think tanks there, by the media there, by non-governmental organizations there, which are important, for example, Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, so important in the context of Kashmir. So, you know, we need to constantly keep engaging the civil society organizations, the media, think tanks, and of course, above all, the Pakistani diaspora. This is a job for diplomats to do. Now you come to the other aspect, which is lobbyists. Mm-hmm. Lobbyists are basically hired help. I mean, that's who they are. You hire this help, you pay them, and they go represent you. And at times, it's important. It's important.
So it's not a free lunch, basically.
It's no, of course not. So, you know, lobbying has two aspects. Mm-hmm. One is the lobbying that officials do, which is extremely important, or officials do through the diaspora. That's lobbying too. Mm-hmm. But the diaspora will lobby with their heart, not by the checkbook. Mm-hmm. Lobbyists obviously lobby because they've been paid to do it. So that's okay. I mean, you can have lobbyists, but we must not think that lobbyists can substitute for the real work that has to be done by that country's official representatives. So they are an additional help, but that's all.
That's kind of a support staff.
They cannot substitute for the work of diplomats. And the diplomats need to, I think, also organize and mobilize the diaspora more effectively. Our diaspora in the United Kingdom, in the United States, is enormously influential. It's you know, well positioned. I think it's very effective when you can mobilize them. What we need to understand is that we are now operating in an international environment which is increasingly multipolar, and therefore Pakistan's ability to have multiple relationships across the board with different countries is going to be very important in the future. And I think Pakistan is well positioned to do that. At the United Nations, I think Pakistan enjoys, I don't think, I know that Pakistan enjoys enormous respect. It enjoys enormous respect for two reasons. I always say it enjoys respect at the United Nations because of hard power and soft power. Hard power because Pakistan has deployed peacekeeping troops. In addition, we've also deployed soft power in terms of our presence, our influence in the realm of ideas. So when you think of somebody like Dr. Mehboobul Haq, and you think of other people like Nafees Sadiq, these are people who served in the United Nations and contributed in the realm of ideas.
Okay.
So you can see that over the decades, we have come to enjoy the respect of the countries represented. There are 193 countries represented at the UN.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, I think Pakistan, that's why I say Pakistan is well positioned to be able to function effectively and ensure that its interests are well understood and we're able to advance our interests in a more multipolar environment. I think you know, the multipolar environment offers Pakistan huge opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
It is for the government now to see how best it can, you know, utilize these opportunities. We're in a completely different world now. This is not the world that existed 10 years ago.
And maybe after 10 years, it is going to be a different ball game altogether.
Yes,
the way technology
yes,
and everything
exactly.
is.
Yes, exactly. And I'm glad you mentioned that, because I think technology and scientific progress also offers huge opportunities to countries like Pakistan, because as you know, we have a very large, you know, we have a large youth base who are able to adapt and absorb skills very quickly. And therefore, you know, our ability to use and deploy the demographic dividend, we use that to ensure that the progress that is taking place, and it's, you know, it's exponential, it's dramatic, it's huge. All this, we're in a position to try to, you know, exploit, use for our advantage, because there are really opportunities.
Their energy needs to be channelized
yes.
in the right direction.
Yes.
Ma'am, one, another aspect, obviously, that is about economy. It is believed that the internal policy of any country is primarily the reflection of its external policy, or the foreign policy for that matter.
No, the other way around.
Is it the other way around? The
other way
external
around.
Policy
external
is
policy,
a reflection of your internal policy?
I mean, your diplomatic strength derives largely from your...
The internal strength.
From your domestic strength.
And I think economy holds the key here, ma'am.
Yes.
The stronger you are, just look at Singapore for that matter. The smaller countries, but with huge exports and financial strengths, especially when you talk about the human resource development and that side. Since you were talking about the demographic dividend, the youth, ma'am, if it's not channelized the right way, this could be your demographic disaster at some stage.
True.
You need to channelize the energy. Over here, ma'am, talking about the economy, talking about the sort of input which we have at the moment, the kind of vision the government has, ma'am, what kind of a role the ambassador has? Because this is something which I always ask, that don't you think that we need to have right people, like the marketing people in certain capitals, in your missions, who can actually go see and understand that what can we export, what can we import, and try to understand and create a balance and equilibrium there.
I think you make a very good point, because you know this obviously plays to my experience in bilateral missions, because obviously at the UN, that's not what we are supposed to do. But I agree. I think our officers who are deployed in these missions, who are assigned in these bilateral missions, need to be oriented towards trade, commerce, and investment. They need to have that exposure, experience, knowledge.
All about diplomatic, when you say economic diplomacy.
And exactly.
Yeah.
And they have to be fit for economic diplomacy. You're absolutely right. I think that reorientation can only take place at headquarters. You know, they have to be trained that way. And you have to be trained to think that way and act that way. And that means also their ability to understand the private sector in Pakistan. What is it that Pakistan has to trade with? What is there for Pakistan to attract investment to? You know, that requires a knowledge of your domestic economy. And domestic contacts. Because a lot of, you know, successful missions, whether it's Pakistan's mission or another country's mission, their success in furthering economic diplomacy depends on the contacts they make and the matchmaking they do between companies from their country and companies from the country where they're assigned to. For that, you need knowledge. For that, you need contacts. For that, you need interaction with the private sector. So I think a more private sector oriented approach for these diplomats who are assigned there will help. And I hope that the government will pay more attention to this.
And let's talk about the East now. China, CPEC, OBOR. Every person in Pakistan, all the political leaders, they all believe in one thing, that this is going to be a game changer. You look at the approach, ma'am, 14 days from China all the way to UK in a train via the Siberian side. Nobody ever thought about it. Just imagine 2 weeks' time. So the world is shrinking. It's getting globalized. Maybe after this 5G technology, God knows what's going to happen. Mm. But ma'am, things are really happening for a reason for Pakistan. Now, if that corridor opens up and starts doing business with Central Asia to Europe, Middle East, all the way Africa, Pakistani location is the prime most place, I would say, when it comes to trade and business. Where do you see Pakistan if everything goes accordingly and that word K for constant stays the same? Do you think, ma'am, Pakistan will be in a different league after 10 years or so?
Well, I have no doubt. I'm very optimistic about Pakistan's future. I think Belt and Road, the initiative of the Chinese government, is one of the greatest economic initiatives of the century. I think the number of countries that have also signed up exactly are part of this shows the sort of scale of this enterprise. It's a huge project. And Pakistan is the pivot. Yep. As you said, it's the key. We can realize a vision that we've had for a long time of Pakistan becoming the hub of communication, trade, investment, and other corridors linking up different regions because of our strategic location. So sure, absolutely. I think Pakistan will have to work very hard, though, on many of the projects that are part of CPEC. I think we have to ensure that all of these agreements are fully implemented. I mean, many are, of course, as you know, as you said yourself, many are in the process of being implementation. Some have already been implemented. Yeah. But it's huge.
We are in phase two, technically.
Yes, yeah. But it's huge. And the potential is huge, and the benefits are huge. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's win-win for everyone. It's win-win not just for China and Pakistan. It's win-win for the entire region. And ultimately, I think, even beyond the region, this is going to bring economic prosperity and perhaps a greater political understanding also between countries. So, you know, this is huge. And yes, sure, it has great promise. And it also will provide an opportunity for Pakistan to be able to provide the people of Pakistan a much better life with all the development that will take place.
Definitely. But ma'am, it is always believed that the future, this century, the 21st century, is the century of Asia.
That's true.
Look at the Chinese model, the economic model, the way they have risen within the last 70 years, became the second largest economic power after USA, beating Japan. So that's a case study, I would say. What have we learned so far from China, ma'am, in that regard? Because our prime minister is always focusing on the Chinese model. We used to hear about the just-in-time formulas of the Japanese and the American case study models, the European models for that matter. Do you think, ma'am, Chinese model is the most suitable model for us?
I think the Chinese have always said to us, as far as I know, that you must, any country, including Pakistan, must choose its own development path and then stick to it. And I think that's very wise advice. Mm-hmm. Because the wisdom of saying you really have to, in a way, create your own model to ensure, one, ownership, that it's yours, and two, yes, of course you can learn. You can learn from best practices from everywhere, including China. But I think Chinese advice that find your own path to development, and once you have found it, stick to it, stay the course, seriously pursue that path. And that path must be for the people, obviously for the of your country. It's not about elites. It shouldn't be for the benefit of an elite. It should be for the benefit of all the people.
Absolutely.
That are. So I think that is something that we should, you know, learn from. Sure.
And the socio-political transition, or let's put it, the economic transition in another way, they're all linked in one way or the other. But depends again. Ma'am, this kind of a shift, I mean, Pakistan was an agro-based country, still an agro-based country, but when you look at your GDP, your agriculture sector is shrinking, your services sector is increasing, manufacturing sector is somewhat the same. Ma'am, the transition which we have seen, let's say, in Vietnam, in Korea, in Malaysia for that matter, Indonesia, these Far Eastern countries, initially there was just Japanese influence, but now we are witnessing the Chinese influence there as well. Ma'am, when it comes to Pakistan, do you believe that our future is towards the manufacturing side? Because we always talk about increasing our exports.
The key is to look to the future and see that we have a solid base. Plus, I think the base...
Do you see Pakistan as a manufacturing country?
No, the point is we need to diversify. I think that's key for our economic future. We are still dependent on a limited number of exports that give us much of our... export proceeds, or much of our foreign exchange, if you like. We need to diversify, and we need to also identify where our competitive advantage lies, and then work on that. And the state must be active in promoting that then. Because I think when you look at some of the development successes or some of the economic success stories in the East, as you yourself referenced, they came about when the state was able to identify their comparative advantage and then work on it. So I think in Pakistan's case too, but as I said, we're well positioned. We have a youthful population. They're able to learn easily. The challenge is to ensure that they have the skills for the 21st century, that they have the education, they have access to education. So we return to one of the most fundamental challenges that Pakistan faces, which is to ensure that every child has access to education. I think that is the basis on which any country's economic success is predicated. Without a literate base, no country has been able to progress. So I do think that we need to put whatever we can in education and ensure that we have an educated, literate population and labor force. And of course, more women in the labor force, because also no country has had an economic success story without women being in adequate numbers in the labor force. Pakistan is still on the lower end. You know, there are fewer women in our labor force than there should be, frankly.
Given, look at China again, I mean.
Exactly.
That's an example.
Look at the other countries, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, all these countries.
Especially the Far East. Yeah.
Yes, I mean, even in the Middle East, female participation
is increasing now.
Yes, and it's
countries like Saudi Arabia,
many
for that
countries
matter.
It's
you'll
higher,
find sales girls there, yeah?
Higher than, so you know, that is also an area that we need to pay special attention to.
Ma'am, recently what we have witnessed in Pakistan, whether you talk about the former ambassador from France, she was a lady, Belgian was a lady, Australian, Canadian, and so many other women, even from Somalia, from Bangla, from Nepal. I mean, there are so many female diplomats working in Pakistan at the moment, ma'am. First of all, ma'am, do you think that since you have served at a very high level, the challenges which a lady or a woman faces versus the challenges a man faces? Is it easy to be a diplomat at that level being a woman, ma'am?
Well, there are two aspects. The first is, of course, that a woman, a professional, whether she's in diplomacy or in any other professional field, she has to prove herself over and over again. So a woman, a professional, is always on probation. So I'll say that.
Always on probation.
Much harder. Much harder.
You're under the microscope.
Yeah. I mean, even if you had 30 years experience, people will say, how is she doing? Is she okay? But they'll never ask that question of a man. But that's fine. I mean, we women professionals...
We recently had a female secretary in the Foreign Office seminar.
We female professionals are used to it. We will work much harder. We will make sure that everyone understands that we're as serious as our male colleagues. So I think that is something that's given. The other aspect is that being, you know, I can tell you a little about my experience at the UN. I was one of 30 odd female ambassadors from different countries. And I must say the Muslim world sent many women ambassadors.
Even in the UN?
Yes, in the UN. Today, UAE has a woman ambassador, Qatar has a UN woman ambassador, and
Nikki
I can go
Haley
on.
Was there as well.
And I can go, but she's from the US. I'm just saying from the Muslim countries, there were several. So when I went, there were about 30. When I left, there were about 50-odd women PRs. And I can tell you that the bond between women ambassadors is extraordinary. The sisterhood amongst us. So that gives us huge opportunity as well as leverage.
And an advantage also.
Well, I don't know about the advantage, but I think the fact that as a club, and I used to convene these meetings of all these women ambassadors, and you can imagine that when Pakistan used to fight an election, and of course I was there for many elections that we won, the votes of these women PRs was very important. Mm-hmm. Of course,
And that, it's a huge number.
That's not to say that they were not asking their capitals. Naturally, it is capitals that take the decision. Mm-hmm. But I think a positive feedback from the ambassador to the capital on the basis of sisterhood does make a difference.
It does.
So I was, this was something very, very important. And I think Pakistan should consider sending more women as ambassadors to different countries.
Do you think that a female ambassador can make a major change as compared to a male?
You need to be good at what you do. So I can't say that female diplomats need a different skill set. But certainly, I think women diplomats, this is coming from a biased person.
No, go ahead, ma'am.
I just think we do much better.
Oh, yes. We all believe that. Ma'am, as a career diplomat, as a female, first of all, because a lot of girls now really want to join civil services, they want to be a part of the other different organizations for that matter. And things are really improving. You just mentioned about 55 ladies who were the ambassadors in the UN. Mm-hmm. That's a big number,
it
by the way.
It is a good number.
Almost more than 27%.
But still not half.
But hopefully
we'll
one day.
We take another 100 years to get to half,
But at least somebody from Pakistan represented. So many Muslim women have also participated there. Ma'am, how to go about it? Like most of these girls, they really want to be a part of that deal. But unfortunately, we do not have that kind of counseling or career opportunities in universities. Don't you think there has to be certain courses which should be taught at the school, not at the school, but the college university level, which can help you develop those sort of skills which are required as a diplomat, ma'am?
I think you're absolutely right. We need new courses. We also need the foreign ministry to be a little more outgoing, to send out teams to campuses, to explain to them, to show them what a great honor it is to join the foreign service and then to have the opportunity to represent Pakistan. You see, you need to attract the best brains, the best talent to the civil service, including the foreign service. And how do you do that? You can't just do that by putting an ad in a paper or by saying that there's an annual exam. I think you need to be proactive, because I think young people need mentoring, as you mentioned, and that mentoring is really not there at a sufficient level and in sufficient strength. So I think we do need a curriculum at campuses, at certain universities, which expose young students, including young girls, to the benefits of joining the civil service or then later opting for the foreign service. I think, it's an exciting career. It is a very gratifying career. It's very rewarding.
Rewarding.
For me, it was such an honor to represent my country every time that I went, and to represent my country at the UN was a special honor, because you're ambassador to the world and you stand there in a global forum, and there is so much riding on your shoulders, So it's a great honor, great privilege, and I would say to every young girl watching this program, this is something that is so exciting and challenging, and you learn so much. Every day is a day of learning. So think about it. Now you can do it. I mean, anyone can do it.
Definitely, ma'am. Now, as we earlier also spoke about the lady secretary of foreign affairs.
Sure.
So, a lot of people are coming up. But ma'am, there's another very interesting aspect. For example, since you have served there in the capacity of an ambassador, a lot of people look up to you that, because you can speak well, you can write well, and obviously you have an added advantage because you were a journalist and you ended up writing two books.
I'm glad you said added advantage of a journalist, because sometimes people think that journalism didn't give us any skill.
I believe
I think journalism gives us so many skills.
Journalism improves your general knowledge also.
Absolutely. See,
and you know exactly. So much, and you can talk, and you can definitely persuade other people.
I'm glad you said that.
Now, ma'am, that side, so in particular, all those who are doing their graduation and want to, for example, join this profession, would you really recommend that there should be some sort of internships or courses offered by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, so that when you talk about the skimming strategy, so you need to have the best of the best, ma'am.
I agree. I think internships are always a good idea because it gives young people the ability to choose between different professions, to actually experience that profession that they will ultimately opt for. So, yeah, certainly. I think there are ways in which young people can be encouraged by offering internships in different places where they learn about global affairs and they're able to actually experience diplomacy, to actually practice it before they decide that they want to sit the exam and join the civil service and then opt for the foreign service. I think there was a debate some time ago on whether there should be a separate examination for young people to join the foreign service.
Foreign service, yeah.
I think there is still value in considering that. Because many people are deterred from sitting this exam because they feel, well, you know, we may not be able to get into the Foreign Service, and that's what we really want to do. So I think there is a way in which we can perhaps review the processes and see whether a separate exam can be set up so that, and then the Foreign Ministry and the Foreign Service, others also yeah. can join in to attract people. And to specialize, you know, because specialization takes place perhaps a little later.
Even if you're doing medicine for that matter, the specialization yes. comes later. Okay, yes. then, you know, like you have the director USA, director Europe, director Australia. One should have a particular focus and then you should. But anyway, ma'am, thank you so
thank
much
you.
For talking to
it's
us.
A pleasure.
It was a pleasure having you, ma'am.
Thank you.
And that's all we have for this hour. I'll see you again till then. You take good care. Khuda hafiz.